Hi, I'm Murphy Griffin.
And I'm Madison Taylor.
And we are the Neophyte Boat Rights.
And we're building a boat.
So what is Neophyte Boat Rights all about? First of all, Madison and I are going to be building a 19-foot sailboat, and we wanted to document the whole process. Secondly, we wanted to put together a how to build a boat video series that was accessible for novices and newbies such as ourselves. So we thought, what better way to do it than to teach from a novice perspective? So we're going to be, as best we can, providing detailed instruction on what we're doing and why we're doing it every step of the way. Thirdly and lastly, we really want to feature boat building culture. There are a lot of builders out there, whether they be hobbyists or professionals, and we really want to connect them all together in one single picture. To that end, we're going to be traveling around the United States, perhaps even internationally, and interviewing and meeting with boat builders and seeing what they're up to. The boat we're going to be building is called the Newfoundland Trap Skiff. It's a 19-foot sailing boat. It has a plank keel, a cutwater stem, a raked transom, and it's going to be planked lapstrake. Provided we get to the end, we're going to give it a catch rig with two sprit sails. Its lines were drawn up by the venerable Walter J Simmons of Duck Trap Woodworking, who we bought the plans off of. If none of this boat anatomy means anything to you, then that's perfectly okay. We'll learn it along the way. The Newfoundland Trap Skiff is what is known as a wherry. That's W-H-E-R-R-Y, wherry. Now the word wherry means different things in different places. So it means one thing in the US and something slightly different in the UK, but ultimately has the same origin. The wherries in the United States are a type of boat that would have been built and used in the Northeast and in maritime Canada. So places like Maine and Newfoundland. What distinguishes wherries from any other type of boat is their wide, flat keels. These flat keels would have made them ideal for dragging up onto the coast, on the shore, and then remaining upright and not tipping over, which is a really nice feature. The wherry keel is also sometimes known as a plank keel. That's because it's such a wide, flat keel that it somewhat resembles a plank. The Newfoundland trap skiffs were originally used for fishing and lobstering, and that's why it's called a trap skiff. Skiff means workboat, and trap means lobster or crab trap. If you look closely at the shear line of the Newfoundland trap skiff, you'll notice it has a low sweep right in the middle of the boat. This would have made them ideal for leaning over and pulling up the lobster pots. So I planned to tell you more about the history of the Newfoundland trap skiff, but then I thought to myself, there's an individual out there who's better equipped and more qualified to tell you about the Newfoundland trap skiff, and that's Mr. Walter J. Simmons himself. There's only one catch, which is that Madison and I are in Florida and Walter's in Maine. So if we want to talk to him, we're gonna have to make a little bit of a trip.
Simmons. Would you mind, here, let me get over here. Just introducing yourself and telling us a little bit about your experience boat building and how'd you get started in boat building? How long have you been boat building?
Forever, pretty much. Introduce myself. I've been building boats since the late 60s, professionally. Not including what we did as kids, because we were always building something as kids. Started 68 in a shop in Rockland, Lee's Boat Shop, as a matter of fact. We were building trawler yachts and 57-footers. And hard to believe now, but I was the youngest one on the crew then. And the oldest wasn't quite as old as I am now, actually. It's a good place to work. I worked there for a couple years. The master builder got fed up and quit. And when he did, I went with him. And we worked at his shop in Camden for a couple years after that. Put out a couple 30s, that kind of thing. The wherries are indigenous to this particular area. All the original wherry builders lived within 3 miles of where we sit right now. Most of them are buried across the street. So they were here. The boats had been here. And there was two different models, a Lincolnville model, which is the older one, and then a later model, which they call the Rhodes model. There's one of those at Mystic. They call it a Wade wherry, but there was never a Wade that ever built a boat. They just owned it. They were fishermen. And a friend of mine who became my machinist years later built one. Mm-hmm. And I kind of liked the looks of it. And when he got done, I took the lines from him, brought it home, and built one. First one wasn't very pretty, but it worked well. And in those days, see, there was nothing on lapstrake boat building in print, nothing. I mean, I had one book on boat building that devoted almost a page and a half to building lapstrake boats. Chappelle's book was out, mm-hmm. boat building, which everybody knew. And in fact, I knew Chappelle, but there was very little on lapstrake. It was always bigger stuff. So got into it and went back to see Merrill. Merrill Young was the master builder that I left with. And he gave me a couple hints, but that was about it. He said, you figure it out as you go along, which I pretty much did. And I've been building those wherries ever since. I can't begin to tell you how many. And probably 200 boats all told.
Wow.
Of information, yeah. Absolutely. Once I got it, I mean, the whole people I learned from are all gone, every one of them. And I took what I learned from them and put it in print so somebody else would have it. Because none of them traveled very far from home ever. And if you didn't kind of stumble onto them, you wouldn't even know they existed. But they had this tremendous trove of information locked up in them that it just wasn't going to go anywhere. It was going to die out. So I put it in print. Ago, had an antique dealer, a marine antique dealer, lived down the road, and he brought me a box of hat models. The reason he brought them to me is to be identified, because an identified model is worth more than one that's not. And down in the bottom of that box was this little plank keel model, sweet, sweet looking model.
Ray, said do that, Ray. Oh, Ray. Oh, Ray.
I identified everybody as best I could, and he wanted to know what I owed him, what he owed me, and I said, I'll take that little model if you don't want it. So yeah, that's fine. It didn't cost me anything, so I got it. And so it's hanging on the wall back over there, and nice lift model, 3/4-inch scale. I didn't know much about it then. I knew it had a plank keel. I knew that the shape of the sections looked really, really good. She's definitely a seaworthy boat. Didn't think much more about it, although I took the lines off it and made another model from it, 1.5-inch scale rather than 3/4, so I could study it better. Hung it up on the wall. And then a couple years later, I figured, I'll take the lines off the model and draw it up, which I did.
Oh, Ray. Ray.
Shortly thereafter, a friend of mine, David Taylor, who's now at the American Folklife Center at the Library of Congress, went off to St. John's, Newfoundland, to work on this, get the information together for his doctoral thesis. And it was on the boatbuilders of Winterton, Nova Scotia, and their trap skiffs. I had drawn, when I drew up the boat, I drew up a sail plan that went with it, guessing at it. Well, David got word while he was in St. John's at the Memorial University that one of the old builders had died. This guy they had always accused of smuggling off the coast, but nobody could ever prove it. And David got permission to go in through his stuff into his barn. And up in his barn, up in the loft of the barn, was a nice light blue-gray Newfoundland trap skiff. Well, blue-gray, 100 yards offshore, does not exist. You cannot see it at all. No wake, no nothing. It's just not there. It's just part of the water. And in it was a sail rig. Took it out and laid it out on the lawn. The mice had gotten to it, but he could lay it out enough that he could get the measurements. And it was virtually identical to the catch rig that I had already drawn for the boat. And they sent me all the dimensions and all that. And another model as well. Again, very, very close to what I had. So we presume. Now, Dan Fortin, the antique dealer, told me this particular model had come from Liverpool, Nova Scotia. But another picker had come through and said that the models in Liverpool had come out of Newfoundland, Conception Bay area, Newfoundland. So I think that's where this model came from. There's marks inside it that indicate stations, the three stations that they use, are indicative of Conception Bay area builders. Anyway, so David continued on and finished up his doctoral thesis, and I helped him with that, and picked up some more information that David had gotten that I didn't know anything about, and we got all that together. David got finished up, he got his doctorate, and I decided I'd build one. That's where Arundel came from. That was the first one, and sweetheart of a boat. God, it's a sweetheart.
Where is she now?
Long Island, New York, Garden City. The fellow that owned her worked at a psychiatric center. He was a doctor, worked at a psychiatric center with severely troubled kids, violent. And they found that if he took his boat there, take these violent kids out and go sailing out on the bay, they'd calm right down. Not only would they calm down then, but they'd stay calm down for 2 or 3 days afterwards. They get wound up again, you take them back up again. So it's a therapy for the doctor as well as for his patients. So he was astonished that it would do that. But they just settled down into that boat and sailed all day long. They loved it. So. Sandwich, they go to Britain a lot. It's grayback, it was on wake, Arctic tern, and then lease tern. Send most of the lease terns to Florida. Lots and lots of lease terns to Florida.
Love me or leave me, let me be lonely. You won't believe me, I love you only. I'd rather be lonely than happy with somebody else. You might find the nighttime right time for kissing, nighttime my time, reminiscing, regretting, and stand up, forgetting with somebody else. There'll be no one less than someone is you. I intend to be independently so blue. I want your love, no one to borrow, have it today, give back tomorrow for my love, your love, no love, nobody else. Love me or leave me, let me be lonely. You won't believe me, and I love you only. Rather be lonely than happy with somebody else. Might find the night time the right time for kissing. Night time is my time for reminiscing. Granting instead of someone is you. I intend to be independently.
So that was episode one of Neophyte Boat Rides. We really hope you guys enjoyed it.
Yeah, and stay tuned for future episodes where we'll be starting the lofting process and showing you how to loft and build a lofting board. Not to mention we'll be stopping in at the Apprentice Shop in Rockland, Maine to talk to a couple boat builders there about their most recent project. They've been working on a historical restoration of a Dublin Bay 24.
Like and subscribe below for more episodes. We've got a Patreon now. This is an expensive project, so we could really use y'all's help to keep it going. We had a great time. I hope you guys did too, and we'll see you next time.